Oh, good morning, everybody. Thanks for bearing with me. I'm gonna hit record on Facebook. Yeah, we're gonna go live on Facebook and I'm gonna say stuff. Good morning. It's Thursday, February 24th, and I am going to read our lessons this morning. And we're live on Facebook and all the other places that we usually are. I have a little background noise today, but that's where I'm at. All right, starting with lesson 55. I hope I said it right way last time.
And good morning, everybody. Luisa, Janine, Marianne,
Thank you.
everybody. Dr. Amy, Taylor, Mary, Sanis, welcome.
Wonderful to have you all here with us. Today's review includes the following ideas from lessons 21 through 25. Review of lesson 21. I'm determined to see things differently. What I egoically see now, without true vision, are but signs of disease, disaster, and death. This cannot be what God created for his beloved son. The very fact that I egoically see such fear-based things is proof that I don't understand God. Therefore, I also don't understand God's Son. What I egoically see, which is a fear-based world, tells me that I do not know who I am. I am determined to see the witnesses to truth in me, rather than those witnesses which show me a separate, fear-based illusion of myself. Bear with me. I'm gonna reread the second one in just a second. There we go. Review of lesson 22. What I see is a form of vengeance. The fearful and meaningless world I see is hardly the representation of loving thoughts. This fearful world is a picture of attack on everything by everything. This fearful world is anything but a reflection of the love of God and the love of his Son. This fearful world is my own attack thoughts that give rise to a picture of an attacking world. My loving thoughts will save me from this perception of a fearful attacking world and give me the peace God intended me to have. Review of lesson 23. I can escape from this world by giving up attack thoughts. By giving up attack thoughts, herein lies salvation and nowhere else. Without attack thoughts, I could not see a world of attack. As forgiveness allows love to return to my awareness, I will see a world of peace and safety and joy. And it is this world of peace and safety and joy I choose to see in place of a fearful attacking world that I look on now. Review of lesson 24. I don't perceive in my own best interests. How could I recognize my own best interests when I don't know who I am? What I mistakenly think are my best interests would merely bind me closer to this fearful, attacking world of illusions. I'm willing to follow the guide God has given me to find out what my true best interests are, recognizing that I cannot perceive my own true best interests by myself. Review of lesson 25. I don't know what anything is for. To me, the purpose of everything is to prove that my illusions about myself are real. It's for this purpose of proving that my illusions about myself are real that I attempt to use everyone and everything. It's for this proving that my illusions about myself are real that I believe the world is for. Therefore, I do not recognize the world's real purpose. The purpose I've given the world has led to a frightening picture of the world. Let me open my mind to the world's real purpose by withdrawing the false purpose I've given the world, which is that of proving that my illusions about myself are real, and instead learning the truth about the world and myself. That's the end of the lesson. I am going to grab a quick cup of coffee and say hello to everybody for a moment. And then I'll read the notes. We'll have our meditation.
Hello, everybody. Steph, go ahead.
I just like that line he kept saying, that this is about proving to my ego that all of my false beliefs about myself are real. I just was running through my head. I love that.
It's really amazing when I can remember, and I could say it's at least 15 to 20 years ago, after I had already gone through the book more than once. Can't really, at some point, I can't go back and say it, on that day it was this many, but it doesn't matter. This is a really good example of peeling back the layers of an onion, the skins of an onion, or whatever metaphor you choose to use, because every time I read through this, I see more deeply into this. And it just helps me to understand that there was so much. The best part of what I've just said is that it keeps getting better each time. The more I understand who I am, the more I'm able to successfully navigate this world, the more I'm able to be loving more quickly if I'm see myself heading into a skirmish of some sort or a disagreement. And yet, at any particular level that we might want to ascribe to it, there's always more. Is it always perfectly good? No. Is it always perfectly bad? Never. In looking back over the time that I've spent studying this and reflecting on so many other types of similar ways of living, the Tao, T-A-O, is just the way. It doesn't really have a deity. But there's a way to live that's better than what we've been doing. And we keep getting better at it. It's more like not just a big left turn and then everything's wonderful. It's more like falling down a funnel and slowly, but sure, I don't know, I should do that in reverse. But it keeps getting a little better each time. It keeps getting, there's more light that comes in. And the ultimate light is for us to be able to see who we are. And as strange as that sounds, because I can recall wondering about that, never really understanding it. It's like, who am I? Well, I'm Bob. What else do you need to know? Okay, I'm Bob Andron. What else? I'm an architect. Okay, that's about it. And of course, there's so much more to it. There's so many other things. And it's pretty wonderful to remember that, because as we go along, you don't become perfect all of a sudden. When you get past this lesson or that lesson, it's all a continual evolving, but it's not taking forever either. The lessons that I learn here are so much more powerful than lessons I've learned in other places that have taught me things about myself as well. So I bring those behind me and I move in this direction. I've gotten to the point I can say that I don't need to search anymore. I have found the place that puts together more of the truth than anything I've ever seen. It's almost an overload, in the sense that I can count on every single word that I read. I never could say that before about anything. Mm-hmm. I would read stuff and, you know, I said, well, this is right, but that's not. No, that doesn't happen for me in A Course in Miracles. Thank
exactly.
you.
Steph, do you want to add something?
Yeah, just a few things that I jotted down when you were talking, Bob. The first thing you started with was, I love reading the book. And for me, and you know how that quote, they say knowledge is power. I think knowledge is light. And this is the perfect example of using things in this dimension to see how much light we've let into ourselves or out, whatever, however you want to think about it. Because there's a quote that says, if it's a good book, you can come back to it over and over again and it will always be different. And for me, that just means that as we change, we will, you know, it's just like as we start to let more and more light in, we will start to see everything differently. So if we read a book and then we change a little bit and read it tomorrow, it'll mean something different and read it tomorrow. And for me, I can see it as using these things in this dimension to see how much I've changed and how much light I've let in, if that makes sense.
Thank sure you. It does.
That definitely makes sense. Yeah. Wonderful. Thanks, guys. Thanks for letting me get a cup of coffee. All right. Notes on Summary Lesson 55. This is from A Course in Miracles Workbook for Dummies. And it's a review of this review of lessons that kind of helps us see it a little bit more clearly. I'm determined to see things differently. What I see is a form of vengeance. Excuse me for a second.
I think I'm going to read for Lee a little bit. His family
is
with him.
I was about to say
it's okay.
that it's probably the best. Right.
Right. Okay. Everything I see. Oh, he was reading the titles first. Lesson 21, I am determined to see things differently. Lesson 22, what I see is a form of vengeance. Lesson 23, I can escape from this world by giving up attack thoughts. Lesson 24, I do not perceive my own best interests. And lesson 25, I do not know what anything is for. One, these are general notes now. Everything I see is a false witness for the ego's thought system. I only see my dream world of provisional reality. This world has already been prejudged. So I only look for selective items that support my current belief. This is not vision yet, but rather image making. Two, Lee, are you ready to pick it up again, or would you like me to keep reading?
Yep, I can pick it up.
Okay,
thanks.
Note two.
This world and my body have a common purpose under the thought system of the ego. They were both made up to convince me that I'm a separate individual that my dream world is real. They're designed to help me forget what I truly am. This world and all of its trappings are a device to sustain my false belief in separate egoic autonomy. It is this belief in separation that has cost me my happiness. Our purpose in this lifetime must be to determine if we're still willing to pay that price. Will I remain in victim consciousness or reclaim my divine birthright? God is unconditional love. To think that a God of love would require his children to live in this world would contradict everything God stands for. We must be insane to believe that God created this world that we perceive. God did not create this world. We did. The backbone of the ego's thought system is to attack and defend against attack. Both prove that we are separate. If we were a oneness of all that is, what would be outside of ourselves to attack? I can only be attacking myself. If we don't remember who we are, how can we know what is in our best interest? If we suffer from amnesia, we can easily be manipulated by a new belief system and become a new person. The goal of the Holy Spirit is to help us remember what we truly are. Tom's point number six here is life is thought. Thought always is the cause, and what results from the thought or manifests is its effect. By the use of projection, the ego's thought system entraps the mind into believing what is outside the mind is the cause, and the mind is an innocent victim of the outside world. The goal of the ego is to maintain your belief that your mind is powerless and is not the source of all you believe. Not the source of all you perceive. The goal of the ego is to maintain your belief that the mind is powerless and not the source of all you perceive. This costs you your happiness, while you get to falsely claim it is not your fault. The Holy Spirit's goal is to reawaken the decision-making part of your split mind so that you can choose a different plan. This time, choose the thought system of the voice of God. When you do so, you become the causative agent of your perceived world. You're now capable, empowered, and responsible for your own happiness and inner peace. 7. Something is meaningless when it has no ability to change your true reality. God created you as part of the one self, your big S, self, capital letter S, right? Big S self remains perfect, whole, and complete. Your denial of your birthright has no ability to change the truth of who created you. Only within the delusional mind of the temporarily insane does the nightmare appear real. The ego wants us to place meaning, either good or bad, on our meaningless dream world. This placement of meaning on the dream by the dreamer gives the imaged thought the appearance of being real. If we buy into the belief that our dream is real, it becomes so in our mind. It becomes our world of provisional reality. This world seems real to the dreamer, but remains unknown in the mind of God. God does not create dreams. lost my place. I'm sorry, guys, I lost my place.
The first paragraph of the 8.
Thank you.
This world seems real to the dreamer, but remains unknown in the mind of God. Okay.
Oh, no, keep going. I still can't find it.
God does not create dreams. I'm finishing up paragraph 7. God's will only extends the truth of the one self. Paragraph 8.
Ah, okay. The world we see, the world we see as our provisional reality is really a thought projection. Our thoughts come first. Thoughts that are based on our individual beliefs are the cause. What we see is their effect. What we claim to see are really thought images that we project into our dream world of provisional reality. Our senses are utilized as thought confirmation devices for our projected thoughts. Our projected thoughts are reflected back to us. When our sense finds something that fits the predetermined objective, they were told to confirm. Because of our ability to make a physical world based on our view of separation and limitation, our senses will always discover a false witness to confirm our projected thoughts. We create our perceived world of provisional reality. Thoughts are things, and the thought, which always comes first, is the cause of what we perceive. Thoughts that are judged and raised to the level of beliefs become our world that we perceive. Thoughts are cause, and experiments are their effect. Experiences. Thoughts are the cause, and experiences are the effect. Under the ego's thought system, we falsely assume that what is outside of our mind came first, and that the outside is the cause of our thoughts. This erroneous thinking helps ensure that we will continue to believe that we're powerless victims, not the controllers of our own provisional reality. Only the Holy Spirit knows both the truth of who you are and your false beliefs about yourself. Because of this, the Holy Spirit has the correct plan to bring you home. This inner guide was placed within your mind, where it can never be lost. This gift from God guarantees your safe return to knowledge. You remain part of the inseparable holographic mind of God. You're perfectly safe. So sit back, laugh a lot, and enjoy the return flight home.
Oh, wow. Tom did a great job of finishing that one up.
He sure did. All right. I'm going to captain our flight back. And we've got a little quick meditation. It's 7 o'clock, so we're just in time. Hope everybody can relax for a moment. Feel where you connect with the world beneath you. Whether it's in your chair or you're sitting on the floor. Realize where you're touching the ground. And feel that root chakra gain some energy as it lights up the rest of your chakras. Pull your body up towards the tip of your skull. Sit up nice and straight so you can take a nice deep breath into your belly. It's a good cleansing breath to start our quick meditation to seat these ideas deep in our minds for the day, to help make a better day where we laugh and we know we're here to be learners. On your next inhale, let's take a deep breath, filling your belly completely for about 4 seconds. 1, 2, 3, and then hold that for just 4 seconds. 2, and then exhale for 4, 3, 2, and inhale, hold it for a moment, 4, 3, 2, and exhale with control. And now just watch your body rise and fall with its breath naturally. I'll go through these individual thoughts for us. Lesson 21. I am determined to see things differently. Lesson 22. What I see is a form of vengeance. Lesson 23. I can escape from this world by giving up attack thoughts. Lesson 24. I do not perceive my own best interests. Lesson 25. I do not know what anything is for. Let's take a few moments today to remember these thoughts, to remember these lessons. We've invested our time here. We're going to get some wonderful results. Take a nice deep breath. Watch that breath fill your entire body. And then exhale with control. Nice and relaxed. It's perfect. Nice, deep breath in. Feel the breath fill your belly and your lungs. You can relax that breath away when you're ready. I am willing to follow the guide that God has given me. Today, that voice will be clearer than ever. And when you're ready, I invite you to slowly open your eyes and come back to here. We've got some time together. I really appreciate you all being with me, here with me. Jordan and Janine, Trisha and Louisa, Dr. Amy, Stephanie, Adriana, Bob, Dad, Tom. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Lee. I just want to share this beautiful part of the book that it's in the regular book, I mean the blue book, that's in the chapter 16, The Forgiveness of Illusions, The End of Illusions is the title of this part. And there's this, like, praying that it's beautiful. So I just want to share it to start the day with this. Forgive us our illusions, Father, and help us to accept our true relationship with you, in which there are no illusions and where none can ever enter. Our holiness is yours. What can there be in us that needs forgiveness when yours is perfect? The sleep of forgetfulness is only the unwillingness to remember your forgiveness and your love. Let us not wander into temptation, for the temptation of the Son of God is not your will. And let us receive only what you have given and accept but this into the minds which you created and which you love. Amen. I wanted to share that with everybody because it is some of the most beautiful parts in the book from my point of view. And because as the lessons are like seeing things differently, and what I see is a form of vengeance, and I can't escape from this world by giving up attack thoughts. So I want just to place this first praying for what I'm going to say. I am not a political person, but I do see what's going on between Ukraine and Russia. And it is heartbreaking in some parts, because it seems like really this whole week has been the content of fears and fears and fears and fears that my life has bring into my own movie. So there are a lot of circumstances this week that really is like, this is the week of fear. So as I am determined and determined to see things differently, I know that what's going on in between these two countries, I cannot control that situation, and I cannot do anything for them. But I can just acknowledge that if this is happening in the world, some part of myself is still playing a role in it. So it's very important for us that we are now practicing this course so regularly and so really wholeheartedly, that even if we don't know which part of our minds is placed in this kind of game, that we take a moment during our day to just really apply the concepts of the book. And if you want, from my point of view, I always use like this Ho'oponopono five words. I'm sorry, please forgive me, I thank you, and I love you. Because all those peoples and all those parts of this world are us. They are in this moment, in this situation, because for some reason we are all having this kind of content, shared content of fear. So if you have a moment in your day, take a moment and just acknowledge that you are part of this world and we are all one. So therefore, if there's any possible world war around the world, it's something that we need to address internally in our minds. So I just want to say that for those two countries, and I just want to say that I'm sorry, I thank you, I love you, and please forgive me, or whatever the order it is. Please forgive me, I thank you, I love you, and whatever. Because I do see myself having this whole week this full content of fear, so I know that there's still a part of me that needs to be consistently determined to only see love and see things differently. We don't need to understand entirely what is going on within Ukraine. I don't need to take part on anything. We just need to address the situation within our minds and our hearts. How have you been this week? How is this week for everybody in their personal lives? Is the content of your week have been rough? Has been tough? Has been full of
it's been
conflict?
Tough.
Yeah.
It's been tough.
Yeah. So no wonder why two countries are about to have a war. So if we all do this in some form, I'm pretty sure that something can be done. But the only thing that we need to do is just be really, really, really determined to see love and be the home of love for those two countries, with Putin and everybody included. We don't get to exclude anybody of this love. So I wanted to share that, because I know that this is a political thing, but I don't want to make it a political thing, because it is all me. So I'm taking responsibility for the part of myself that it's causing this situation in some form.
I think that's fantastic.
That is so beautiful.
That is really the right way to apply this.
Beautiful, Adriana. Yes. Thank you.
Can you imagine what Adriana would be like if she really totally had complete command of the English language. Oh my God.
I think I get
It's
what you're
so
saying. I think it's great.
adorable to watch, to listen to you, to see your even your expressions change and get and grow. And I think that's what this is all about, again, is about evolving. We're not going to become perfect by Tuesday. And I was in, I think I told most of you, I was in Scientology many, many years ago, back in the 60s. And there was a sign on this classroom wall. It was so huge that each letter was about 5 feet tall, and it went across this entire room. And this one sign that they had was, "You are totally responsible for the condition you're in." Even the word condition was power packed with that group. And the difficulty that I had when I finally escaped and left was that some of it was very real to me, and but some of it also eluded me, and I couldn't figure out where they were coming from, and I couldn't figure out if there was a place of love in there. It seemed like everything was about power. And it's easy to confuse those two because I think that's what the separation in it, part the separation is a lot about the difference between power and love. The ego wants power. This is the way I see it today. And the Holy Spirit wants us to love. When you have power, very often it's like a war. Divide and conquer. You don't have to conquer everybody that way. And you do these kinds of things that wreak havoc on our world. In the bigger picture, I see it so clearly now that I couldn't possibly have seen it this way then. That love is the greatest power there is. It's the glue that keeps us coming back and staying together. And as we divest ourselves of each of the little prickly things that we have about ourselves that incite others to react quickly against us, we remember, I can remember already, we're only at lesson 25 here, to remember that the ego usually is the first voice that we hear, especially if there is a perceived or imaginary danger in front of us, even if that danger is simply of being misunderstood, misjudged, and really denigrated. So at every point, all the way through this book, we are told, when I say we here, I'm talking about Lee and I, who took a course in how to teach this from Robert Perry, who was the editor. He says, "Whatever you do, if you don't understand what you're reading, don't make up your own explanation. Don't even necessarily call in something else that you once thought was true. Instead, look at what the book says." Most of the time, any confusion can be fixed that I have in reading something if I just go back a paragraph or two and catch up again to where I was. Or sometimes I have to just go forward, not knowing for sure, but with the idea that I know it's going to get better. I continue to
I
have
had to do
that
that this morning.
attitude. Yep, we all do. And I don't want to belabor this. So anyone else who wants to pick up at any point, I just think it's really important to see that what this book says is just it. It's better than the New Testament in the sense that it corrects a few things that the New Testament misunderstood because there were still human beings who were actually putting the words together. That's hard to take for some people, many of us who came up believing that every single word is true. And I can tell you one last thing, that when I was growing up in the Jewish faith, even as far back as the fifth grade, I was talking to my brother about this the other day. We studied what's called Gemara, and the Talmud is the English word for it. And the rabbis, who basically argued, is it this or is it that? That's what the whole Talmud is about. And usually one particular rabbi in each case is the one who had more wisdom, and he makes us come around to his reasoning. But it's amazing. I mean, just take the first sentence here. I am determined to see things differently. They, in that Talmud, it would be like, I am, okay, am. See, it's not was, it's not could be, it's I am, okay? That's just for today. Tomorrow, I don't know. Determined. Well, I think I should. Am I determined? Well, maybe not. To see things differently. Differently? How different do you want? You want me to see everybody upside down? And you parse all this stuff, and it sounds silly as I say it now, but I can tell you that that's the way I was trained. And so every word is important, or it wouldn't be here. I can go with that. It works for me. And for that, I'm complete for now. Let's have some
Thank
other
you, Wolf. Tom is willing to speak, right?
Yeah. In regards to, you know, what you guys are saying, it's important to realize that we have control. I have control of my own inner world. I don't necessarily have control of in time and space, the external world. The external world is, you know, a creation of the mass collective consciousness. And the world, the mass collective consciousness, is a fear-based world. It has what it wants to create, okay, which, of course, this is where they say, we have a seeming world of hate and fear. This is, you know, this world throws circumstances out towards us. We don't have control of all those circumstances. We don't really, we can't, quote unquote, stop a war in, you know, between Ukraine and Russia, for example. But what we can do is we can control how we want to view that, which is our old inner world. So although we don't have control of all the circumstances that swirl around us, all the events, because that's done on a more of a mass collective consciousness, we always have 100% control of how we're going to choose to interpret those events, how we're going to respond to it, and whether or not we're going to allow that to impact our inner peace. In this world of time and space, you know, and Scientology and, you know, basically fairly, you know, aware of this idea that I'm totally responsible for everything. But in this world of time and space, we're not the only kid in the sandbox. So we're not playing alone. There's other people, other mass collective conscious thoughts in there. And when you're playing in the sandbox, we'll find that the universe is going to throw sand in our face. And that's for us to then decide how we're going to react. Are we going to lose our inner peace, or are we going to maintain our inner peace? Are we going to respond in a loving way, or, you know, how we'll respond? And this world just tests us how we can live our principles in the sandbox of the collective consciousness. So, you know, one thing that spiritual people often have a, going to say, problem with is this idea that we tend to think that we're we should be able to solve everybody else's problem or the problems of the world. And that's not our responsibility. Our responsibility is to control our own inner world and to respond to the outer world in a way that aligns with our principles of our inner world. And that's what we're here to do, to see how whether we can do it when the rubber meets the road. And if we think that we can fix others or change others or solve other people's problems, I'll ask you this question. How do you solve my problem when my problem is I don't want it solved by you? You just can't. And when you overreach your responsibility and think you can take care of Tom's problem, you disempower yourself and you disempower me, because you're basically saying that I'm too stupid to be able to make my own way and that my path is somehow wrong. And we have to see everybody as on their own perfect path and allow them to be that way. That's why Jesus said, if you want to be like me, knowing that we are the same, I will help you. If you want to be different, I will wait until you change your mind. Jesus isn't going to slap you beside the head, say you're stupid, follow me. He's going to say, no, I understand where you are. You're on your own perfect path. If you want to experience those things, want to experience hate or fear or whatever, pain, that's up to you. Whenever you change your mind and you want to realize that you're part of the oneness of all that is, perfect, whole, and complete, I'll help you. But I'm not going to judge you or make you wrong for wherever you are on your own perfect path. Thank you. I'm complete.
My first thoughts at the beginning were about an attack situation I was involved in yesterday and with a client. And I'm getting a lot better at the part. I've always been pretty level-headed and not much of an attacking person, but not saying I'm perfect or anything, but especially now, it's the bigger challenge is being responsive and not reactive if I am being attacked. And that happened yesterday, where I became reactive instead of responsive. But the good news is that it stayed at the level of email and text communication. And I was pretty calm in the words that I used. But my feelings were really like I was at a low boil level for most of the afternoon. And I'm taking actually a practitioner course in the evening, and Emma Hopkins, actually, and which is a wonderful, powerful course. And yet it's was still seeping into my brain about this attack situation earlier. And I was kind of annoyed with myself that I was allowing it to simmer within me. But I was able to shift the thinking to being loving toward myself and giving myself loving, accepting thoughts. It took some time and to let myself know that it was okay what I was dealing with. And then Adriana, when you came in, and actually something Bob had said earlier about going along, we're still learning and we're going to still have these situations, but learning how to manage these situations more effectively, knowing that, we are love and part of God and oneness, and going into that space. And I love how your reflection, Adriana, about the war going on and how it relates to us. And it's like we're truly connected, this idea of this macrocosm, this larger system that we're a part of and affected by, and how we all in our own lives have these little conflicts. And I was thinking how all these attacks always start with some kind of belief. And this belief turns into this line of reasoning. And there's error in this line of reasoning somewhere. And I envision these leaders sitting at a table. And at some point, there was a line of thinking and some kind of reasoning that led to this whole conflict there and that was erroneous. And it would be nice if the leaders could track back and see, that their line of thinking was off somewhere and to become introspective, and correct it on paper, somehow before it reaches the level of physical confrontation. So I am proud of myself that I handled it at the paper level and it never became verbal, never went. It just kind of fizzled there. So, but that's my share, my thinking about that. Thank you.
Wow, Janine, that was wonderful.
May I add something, please? This is Dr. Amy.
Sure.
Good morning. I wasn't going to speak today, but rather listen about the things that are happening globally, and I am quite aware outside of the headlines because I do globally life coaching areas where, well, there's much militance and a separation in their perception of what is, what Jesus and the Holy Spirit would like us to be one with. And with the war with Bosnia, the war in Somalia, many different wars in Afghanistan, there are many, 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 many in Africa. We can send out the love and not react in such a way that is fearful. Because once the fear is removed, then we can breathe and offer that love and that perspective he has given us so that we can one day, any cultures are behind us and things happen within our own cultures. Like what Janine had said, someone had. She did not react, which, yeah, bad. But instead responded, but she spent some time on it. And I guess the best place to stand is one in which fear is not present. Because Jesus and the Holy Spirit have given us the perception in order to see it more clearly. Through what God and the Holy Spirit and Jesus Himself are teaching us. And so, for that reason, I do not operate from a space of fear, but instead a place of extreme hope that all these perceptions, throughout how much time it might take, will always bring us back to. The idea of sacrifice can be removed from the world's thinking because there is none. And in that sense, yes, our holiness does bless that world. And for me, this is where I stand on it. When COVID came, I wasn't afraid. It was the news media selling that fear. And yes, they're at warring with us. Another, one another, whether in writing, trying to make treaties, they still fall short. And so I'm just getting so much from this, and it's creating in me so many beautiful things. I had a confrontation with a Russian man who was somewhat misogynistic and oh, women should be, I don't know, submissive to men, etc. And I was in the room and I stayed in a space of, Well, this is his perception. It certainly isn't mine. So he tossed me in the audience, and so I stayed there. And there was a Muslim man who lived in that culture where women are predominantly in a masculine society. And you know what? That man, the Muslim man, said, I would like to escort you from this room because I have never seen a woman treated so badly, and I come from a Muslim country that's been in the masculine paradigm for so very, very long. And that gave me a sense of true joy to see someone who's more deeply entrenched in that kind of thinking to offer me a hand to say this was, you know, an egregious attempt to take away your femininity, your voice, your personage. And I dealt with that pretty well. And actually, I believe he was there to point it out to me. I'd like to ask one question before I end, and thank you for hearing me. It's lesson 43. It says, in God you cannot see. I'm using the blue book, so perhaps it's stated differently in the purple one, which is newly released, which I will definitely purchase. It says, perception has no function in God and does not exist. Yet in salvation, which is the undoing of what never was, perception has a mighty purpose, made by the Son of God for an unholy purpose. It must become the means for the restoration of His holiness to awareness. Perception has no meaning. Yet does the Holy Spirit give it a meaning very close to God's? Healed perceptions becomes the means by which the Son of God forgives his brother and thus forgives himself. So it is through our perceptions that we can forgive one another and ourselves. And that just reckons with me every time. And I wanted to add that, and thank you for your shares. And to be fearful is not what he wants. Thank you so much. This is Dr. Amy yielding her mic.
Thank you, Dr. Amy. Thank you for your comments on this. So I will have to say goodbye for now because I have to get ready for school, to take a school, my daughter. So I wish everybody a wonderful morning. And I thank everybody here for the time that you are taking each day to join us. And this week has been really challenging, but I know that I'm just determined to see only light and only love. So all my love to you, and have a wonderful day. Think about how your week is going and how the content of your week has been bringing you fear or these thoughts of conflict, to try to apply this on your life. So thank you,
everybody.
Thank you,
Adriana. Have a beautiful day.
Yeah, you too, Danny. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much, Adriana. I really appreciate it. And if you guys wouldn't mind kind of bearing with me, I had to restart everything. I'd like to read the lesson one more time for us. So that I kind of got it at the beginning of this recording. And it's going to be good enough for today. I appreciate patience. And for those that participated, you guys know all the wonderful stuff you've already received. thank goodness we're getting the people in here to help us reframe some of this crazy world that we're going through so that we can see it a little bit more clearly from this perspective that we're talking about here. I still find it hard to keep this frame of reference in my mind when I'm going through a rough time. So I really appreciate reframing starting my day the right way. All right. All right.
I'm glad I'm not the only one, Lee.
You are the only one.
It feels like it's a big lesson for all of us, especially as easier going through it with others than yourself, right? It sure is. All right, here we go. Lesson 55. Today's review includes the following lesson idea from lesson 21 through 25. Lee, just before you jump in, I'm going to have to, in about seven minutes, and I don't know if you finished this, but I just want to say in general, this is a beautiful morning, and the series of comments everyone has made is so poignant, and yes, there's a war going on, but I'm older than most of you. And probably all of you. I just want to say I've lived through several of these events, and I don't think this one is going to be anywhere near as bad, and I urge you all to watch the news enough so that you understand things that you didn't understand before. But not so much that you just end up being full of fear, because there really is no fear. Fear really is an illusion. Let's all try and go through this time now that is being presented to us by some characters on the other side of the planet to engender fear in us. That's what they do, to bend their will and know that we don't have to do that, that we're going to be okay because God has our back, and hope that God will become more apparent on that side of the planet as we go forward also. There's all kinds of good things we can learn about ourselves as we watch this go forward. And the one thing to watch is when are we hearing the truth, and when is it clearly not the truth? Watch for that, because that shows you that the people who are not able to really express the truth or what is in front of everybody's face are the ones who are trying to gain power in any way that they can. We can learn a lot by being detached from everything that's going on. We're fortunate, most of us live on this side of the planet, not all of us. And there is much that we can get, and as we do that, we put more of ourselves, who we really are, which is a piece of God, into the world picture. And in some way, as this book says so many times, we might be able to alleviate some person here, some person there, of a pain that may not be quite as deep as it would have been had I not considered the people that are over there. So we have much to gain from this. We want to stay on the side of love, forgiveness for everyone, because that's what we're being taught to do. And we're also being told that's going to get us all, the entire planet, and all beings here, into a better place. So I put that in, and I'm going to turn it back to you, Lee. Thank you so much for this morning. This is just wonderful.
Great. I'm glad that helps. That's fantastic. Thanks for that. I appreciate that. And you all can interrupt me if you need to. I'm doing the best I can to give us what we got, but I want the Holy Spirit to breathe as much life into this as we can.
So, before you begin, I'd like to dismiss myself because it's very early and I have a doctor's appointment, and I should rest a little bit before I go.
Thanks for joining us, Dr. Ramey. Appreciate it.
Oh yes, and thank you all very much.
Sure, we'll be back tomorrow. Have a beautiful, loving, and fear-free day.
Amen.
Bye, Dr. Amy. Have a great day.
Thanks, everybody.
Bye.
All right.
Hello.
I'm going to do my... Papa, I'm going to leave the admission to you while I read this, okay? That you invite anybody up who wants to come.
I only have about four minutes.
I'm sorry, I got it. I'm going to recruit Lisa.
And I'm a recruiting moderator. Okay, so now if anybody raises their hand, you guys can invite them if they want to. That way I keep my eyes on the book and not sitting up. All right, that was a very nice recruitment. Yay, yay. I do appreciate it.
All right, lesson 21 through 25. Today's review includes the following ideas from lesson 21 through 25. I'm determined to see things differently. What I see now without true vision. Are but signs of disease, disaster, and death. This is from A Course in Miracles workbook for dummies, by the way. Sorry I didn't say that, but I want to be clear where it's coming from. And if you're in the stream, you can read along with me, and I'll get links out to Facebook groups and stuff like that. Eventually. What I go to see now without true vision are but signs of disease, disaster, and death. This cannot be what God created for his beloved Son. The very fact that I go with such fear-based things is proof that I do not understand God. Therefore, I also do not understand God's Son. What I go to see, which is a fear-based world, tells me that I do not know who I am. I'm determined to see the witness to the truth in me, rather than those witnesses which show me a separate, fear-based illusion of myself. Review of Lesson 22. What I see is a form of vengeance. The fearful and meaningless world I see is hardly the representation of loving thoughts. This fearful world is a picture of attack on everything by everything. This fearful world is anything but a reflection of the love of God and the love of His Son. This fearful world is my own attack thoughts that give rise to this picture of an attacking world. My loving thoughts will save me from this perception of a fearful attacking world and give me the peace God intended me to have. Review of Lesson 23. I can escape from this world by giving up my attack thoughts. Herein lies salvation and nowhere else. Without attack thoughts, I could not see a world attack. As forgiveness allows love to return to my awareness, I will see a world of peace and safety and joy. And it is this world of peace, safety, and joy that I choose to see in place of the fearful attacking world that I look on now. Lesson 24. I do not perceive my best interests. How could I recognize my own best interests when I don't know who I am? What I mistakenly think are my best interests. Would merely bind me closer to this fearful attacking world of illusions. I'm willing to follow the guide God has given me to find out what my own true best interests are. Recognizing that I can't perceive what my own true best interests are by myself. Review of Lesson 25. I don't know what anything is for. To me, the purpose of everything is to prove that my illusions about myself are real. It's for this purpose of proving My illusions about myself are real, but I attempt to use everyone and everything. It's for this proving that my illusions about myself are real that I believe the world is for. Therefore, I do not recognize the world's real purpose. But the purpose I have given the world has led to a frightening picture of the world. Let me open my mind to the world's real purpose by withdrawing the false purpose I've given the world, which is that of proving that my illusions about myself are real, instead learning truth about the world and myself. Thanks for letting me read through that again.
Could read the notes again.
I think for today, that's going to be enough. If anybody else has like to share,
spread,
invite your voice.
Yeah, I do. Excellent. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, Caro. How are you?
good. Thank you. I just have one question. This lesson. That says what I see is a form of vengeance. That is the one lesson. I believe it's the only one. Maybe there's another one, but it's one of the very few that I can honestly say I don't understand what they mean by the word vengeance. So I just wanted to ask that question and see what the panel can share about that.
I know Tom has a pretty good answer for that, but I will only say that I always took that lesson specifically as the part of myself that is mad at God, because things that God put me in this place. You know, if you conceive the idea that you are separate from God, then you are dealing with the content of duality as the conflict it represents as a form of vengeance. That's the way that I thought about it, but I don't know if it is right or not. It's just that my thought process during this practice has been really revealing me the anger that I have been dealing with in myself deep down inside of me for being just here, for being in this level of the form. It's like if it was some form of vengeance to God, to me, or me to God. I don't know. But I know Tom has a very good answer for this, better than mine. I'm just new in this process.
Well, I think you instinctively got it too. I'm ready for your time.
In regards to this world, the belief in separation. So it's the belief that there's something wrong with us, that we're sinners, that we lack, that we're separate from God, and that God is actually believes that somehow we've fallen or that we've sinned. A few days ago, the laws of chaos were mentioned, which was the idea that truth differs from people to people, from person to person. That we believe that we're sinners and that everybody's sinned. That God believes has decided that we're right, that we really are sinners, so that he believes that we're sinners. The fourth law of chaos is that what we have, we have to take from somebody else. So it's a zero-sum game, that we're separate, we're not part of the oneness. And then the fifth one is the idea that there is a substitute for love, which is fear, but really for us, we might call it conditional love, which is really a sense of bartering in which I believe that I can fix, change, control, protect, or impress somebody because it's either my duty or because I need them. This world is the belief that we're separate, and from that standpoint, it's an illusion. It's not real. And so, you know, whenever they say it's a form of vengeance, I don't know if you want to say that it's really trying to make our belief in ourselves that we're sinners, that we lack, to make that appear real. But it's just an illusion. We just need to wake up. And this is what they're saying kind of in this lesson, that what we, I think the last one, where they say we really have to do is change our idea of what the purpose of this world is for. This world is for us to reawaken to the truth of what we are, that we're learners and we're removing the blocks that we place in front of love, which is what we truly are. But when we think that we're an earner, that we're a sinner, then we're basically trying to earn something that can't be earned because it was never lost. So we need to change the purpose of what this world is, from us thinking that we're here to earn redemption, to the realization that we are, as God created us, perfect, whole, and complete. You know, as it says, I am not a body, I am free, I am still as God created me. Nothing sources my experience but me, and nothing can cause me to lose my inner peace unless I choose to allow it. So it's our own choice, and we just need to move from that earner mentality, which we've been brainwashed into believing, and is kind of a vengeance about our true nature, and open it up to the reality that we are, as God created us, still part of that oneness, perfect, whole, and complete. And each is on their own perfect path. I don't know if that, hopefully that helps. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Tom. That was wonderful.
Good morning, good now, everybody. This is Sherry.
Hi, Sherry. Thanks for coming out.
Oh, thanks for having me. I am rather embarrassed to be asking this. On a personal level, I've studied the course, and I'm rather tongue-tied this morning. Had no trouble seeing what it is teaching me personally, but at this moment, to be honest, on a global scale with what's going on, I am having trouble with that, with Ukraine and Russia, and wondered if somebody could offer me some insight or help with that. It's easier for me to okay, I get it, this is me one-on-one looking in the mirror and I'm separating, but in a much bigger picture, even though it's all me, I'm still having more trouble, and I just wondered if somebody could offer me some insight so I could get back to being love and knowing that I am an extension of God. Thank you for listening to me ramble.
Yeah, I don't know if this is going to help or not, but when you realize what the purpose of this world is, at least from the egoic standpoint, the purpose of this fear-based world is to instill fear in everybody and to actually test us as to whether or not we can be love-informed whenever people are kicking sand in our face. This world on a collective basis, we don't understand the big picture. The big picture is that everybody has various learning lessons that we're here to absorb and grow. And that's done on a much larger basis, and we don't have to understand how all the parts fit together, but everybody's on their own perfect path. And for some people, they may actually desire, as hard as it may seem to believe, the idea that they need power, they need something, because they see themselves coming from the idea that there's lack limitation. And the ego's world tells us that this is a fearful place, and that we need to, because we're not perfect, whole, and complete, we're always trying to seek happiness from outside, which means that people on an egoic basis think that they're fine. Inner peace or happiness when they get fame, wealth, power, sex, those type of things are good health, that they think that those things are external. And so those people that are on that trajectory, they're exactly where they're supposed to be. So what we really need to probably become aware of is that this fear-based world is perhaps not our home, not where we actually want to be. And we want to test our skills, learn that we can maintain our inner peace, even in a world of seeming hate and fear, and then decide whether or not we've learned those lessons and whether or not we have to test ourselves in the future. So maybe sometime in the future, we might decide not to reincarnate in a fearful world. So everybody's on their own perfect place. We're all, we don't have to understand the big picture. We just have to trust that the Holy Spirit, the one that writes the curriculum, God, the universe, everything's unfolding as it's supposed to, and not judge others for where they are, just appreciate what they are and say, wow, what an interesting creation. People want to make war on each other. People want to do that. That's something that I, as an observer, could look back and say, interesting creation. I don't think I want to participate in that. Or, and see how I'm going to respond as an observer, but maybe I don't want to become an active participant in it, or I want to act differently. But that's for me to test my skills to see if, in this world of seeming hate and fear, can you still trust in the big picture and realize that you're a spiritual being having an earthly experience, and that we're all on our own perfect path, and we all have something to learn from that. We need to have a world that throws adverse circumstances and events our way so that we can have the relationships and hone our skills, test it. So I hope that helps. Thank you.
Hey, this is Sean. I'd like to kind of follow that up. Probably much more brief. What comes to mind is that saying that you are not your mind. You are so much more of an ineffable and larger spirit than that.
Sean, can you come closer to your mic, please? Thank you. Sorry about that. No, don't worry. You're okay. Just a little bit far away.
That's okay. So I'll start over again. That, there's a spiritual teacher that says that you are not your mind, because they really don't want to limit you to just what you can think of, right? The spiritual experience is a feeling experience. And, you know, through feeling and through imagining, you know, the formlessness of God and of the spirit, it's impossible to write it down. It's impossible to put it into some container that fits in the logic of the mind. And that logic of the mind is very deceptive in the way that it presents fear, in the way that it presents mistruths, in the way that it presents even to itself, right? So at some level, I know I can't trust my mind. I'll share something. I have bipolar. And so by default, I actually can't trust my mind. And, you know, I've also been through quite a lot of trauma recently, lost my mental stage for cancer over Thanksgiving. A week later, my wife leaves, and, you know, Christmas alone, and then, like, earlier this week, I see some lady get run over by a car while I was trying to get my oil changed. So, needless to say, there's been a lot of trauma that, you know, if I try to intellectualize, I can go into a very dark place very fast. And by realizing that there is a larger plan, that there is something that I can't see, there is an end goal that is part of all this that is beyond my comprehension. You know, like having someone who's a very dark public influence, you know, is very bad, right, at some level. But then what happens to a society that reacts to that and says, no, I'm not going to take that anymore, right? There's a lot of strength that follows up difficulty, and that, you know, this difficulty will bring strength in the long term. It's just we have to have faith, and, you know, without it, I would be in a very dark place, and, you know, I would offer up to you that, you know, stay out of your mind. Sometimes that can be a very dangerous and dark place.
Thank you, Bob. That was something off what Sean said.
It's not so much what we do, it's why we do it. So Sean's point is an excellent one. You don't have to be, quote unquote, awful. You don't have to just be something that people run over you. You can look and discern what you feel you need to do and take the appropriate actions. Realizing that you're not necessarily doing it because of hate and fear, you're just doing it because that's what you're guided to do. Otherwise, you can stand up to a bully, and realize that maybe, for example, you can poke the bully in the eye, or kick him someplace else. And that doesn't necessarily mean that you've quote unquote failed. If you went in and you asked for guidance and that's what the information was, you may very well be playing the role of someone that's trying to teach the bully that that's not an appropriate thing to do. The bully needs actors that will play the part to counteract their actions so that they can go and learn too. So we're not just supposed to sit here and say, well, this person wants to take over this country or whatever, and that's fine. You can still respond appropriately, but the reason is, why are you responding? Are you arguing for your rightness? Or have you gone within, asked for higher guidance, and just follow that response? You know, so it's not so much what we do, It's why you do it. So fear arises anytime you fail to get either of these two questions wrong. The first is, what am I? And the second is, what do I value and why? If you value something because you're arguing for your rightness, if you're arguing or you're valuing something because you think you need it to make you happy, that's a problem. If you're doing something because that's what your guidance is, or that is following your inner principles that you've chosen to guide your life, then you're still in alignment with that inner self, and you will not necessarily have to lose your peace because you poke someone in the eye. You're just acting as an instrument, so to speak. And it's better that you poke them in the eye with love, without this idea of vengeance, than I poke them in the eye with the idea that I'm trying to get even or make myself right, teach them a lesson. Okay. We're just actors all playing our role. And, you know, sometimes we're a participant, sometimes we're an observer, often we're both. But even whenever we're a participant, should move into that observing base and get the feedback that the lesson was designed to teach us. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Appreciate that.
Go ahead.
I think both of what you said was invaluable to me. And in my meditation and talking with spirit, what I heard was similar to both of what you had to say. So that was very helpful to me. And I just wanted to make sure, we can never really make sure, but know that I was listening from the place of love and connection to spirit as opposed to my ego. So I appreciate all of you and Tom and Sean. Thank you for taking the time to respond.
No problem, Sherry. That was great. I really appreciate Tom's and Sean's sharing too. I'm having trouble this week. I'm definitely continually sometimes 10 minutes at a time, stopping and saying a prayer, get myself back into this perception, reviewing the lessons. Some days are like that. They're not all easy and perfect, but more of my days are easy and I stay in this default perspective most days out of my year as compared to where I used to be. So all I can say is have some encouragement that one step at a time, it does get easier. And Tamara's brand new to our platform, and I invited her up here, and so don't feel like I'm putting you on the spot. But if you do feel like talking, you can come off the mute on your mic. We do sometimes show that we clap, flashing our mics like that. That little flash is usually pretty well. It works out pretty well. And that's probably all you really need to know. You're here. Love to hear. Maybe how you found the book found you.
Thank you for the welcome. I found the book years ago, probably about 20 or less years ago, from a friend who was moving out of the country. He had a box of books, and he was giving them away, and I got one. I got a lot of them, and that was one of them. And then I had it for a very long time, and I read it. I got through the lessons to 80, but I read the whole first part of the text and was blown away by it and loved it.
That's awesome. I actually couldn't even make it through the test until I had done the lesson once. I had to clear it out so that I could even make sense. So I can tell you this, Tom, the guy who was talking before, He's actually the author of A Course in Miracles, Workbook for Dummies, and that's what I read out of. He went back to the Blue Book and added in a whole bunch of extra stuff that made it extra clear for me. I wrote it for Dummies book too, about website design, so I get the Dummies part. But adding in that clarity is helpful. That's what I read from, so I read the main lesson. And then I also read some notes. And I lead us through a meditation every morning starting about 6:37. And we meet here since July 4th. Tom joined us very late last year. We were just finishing up reading through the main text. And it's been really helpful to kind of have some continued reminders. There's also several people here who have locked into this way of thinking about the world in a way that I haven't quite gotten to yet. And so hearing from them how it kind of practically hits the road, let's say, with this stuff, it's really helpful to me. Just on a personal level, for some background, I'm a dad with a couple of kids outside of Boston, and we're making it through life one day at a time. You know, it's not all perfect, but there's a lot more time smiling now. And what can I say? I'm grateful you're here. And we usually start wrapping things up about now. So, Kara, if you want to share, I'd be happy to hear from you. Other than that, we could start wrapping things up. Let me know. Go ahead, Kara. Sorry. What a good intro. Or maybe you don't realize you're on off the mic. Okay. I thought maybe you wanted to share. No big deal. So tomorrow we'll be back here at about 6:30 in the morning. Up above are links to the Facebook group, and I also have acourseinmiracles.live, and it streams out to that every day too. So what I was trying to do here is make a wide open space for anybody who wants to come and try and practice these lessons with us. But everybody's welcome, and I appreciate you guys joining me on Clubhouse. That's where we do the majority of this. And I'm making pancakes. And my daughter's going to make pancakes. Life is good.
Can I just say, please, I just want to thank you so much for this space. It really helps so much. It feels like home, really. And you make it so equitable. Because I've been in other rooms. Some rooms can make you feel like, You're not as important as this one and that one in the room. And I never feel that way here. And I appreciate you being just really candid and open about your life. I like what you just said. This is a dad up here with a couple of kids in Boston. And I was like, yeah, you know, I'm a mom. I got two grown kids. My mom lives with me, and we're making it work. Every day is a new day. And it just made it real simple, put it into perspective. We're all living our lives and just coming here together and being open and just getting down into these lessons. And it just helps so much on a day-to-day level. I just wanted to say thank you, Tom and Adriana and all of you. Sean, I just really appreciate all of you. Thank you.
We appreciate you being here, Janine. I swear your voice really adds a whole layer of color that it really is helpful.
That's so funny to me, and I was thinking about your voice saying earlier how you have things going on. Lee sounds so cool. Like, he doesn't sound like any drop of sweat would come down his forehead. But I enjoy your voice as well, and Adriana, yours as well.
Well, maybe my tone, because my words were not quite in the sweet spot that I wish it was. They were, so I'm really thankful for you and everybody here. So we will keep doing this as long as we are allowed to by God. So I'm sure that we are all part of the same source. We are all glad to be together because we are
having this experience of oneness among each other. So it's a beautiful thing to have to realize that we are from different places, different backgrounds, different languages, but yet still we are one.
So that is a beautiful recognition and a beautiful example of the practice of this book.
So I'm really thankful for everybody as well. And I will keep going my day with this beautiful thought that we all have been dealing with fear, contentment with this week, but we are still determined to only see love and God. Not the preoccupation. So I'm pretty sure that everything will turn out okay for everybody.
Kisses and hugs, everybody, and be, I love you, you know, much love. Yes, I do. Thank you so much. I gotta tell you guys, one of the biggest miracles in my life is coming here and holding this space, I guess, I can tell you I'm truly blessed. For your joy, and I really appreciate it. Helping my practice more than anything. So thank you. And we'll be here tomorrow morning too. And in the meantime, if you need us, we'll be out in the Facebook groups. And got a channel set up on Discord that works for you. If I can help, I'll be here. Either way, I'll be here tomorrow morning. Have a wonderful day, everybody.
Create a great day. Namaste. Bye.
Goodbye, everyone. See you tomorrow.
Namaste. Love and light.
I hope y'all have a wonderful day. End on the room. See you in the morning.
Thank you, Lee.
Thanks, Sherry.